thanks to the entire Gulf South community for making Ochsner Medical Center one of the nation's best hospitals. At Ochsner, we are passionate about relentlessly pursuing advancements to overcome the toughest healthcare challenges. That's why U.S. News & World Report once again ranked us the number one hospital in Louisiana and in the top 50 in the nation in three specialties. Discover how we're putting big ideas to work at Ochsner.org/relentless. Ochsner, innovating healthcare.
Buddy, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the Lovely Laura.
Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, folks, we're heard on more platforms than an Olympic diver. FNX.network, iTunes, Stitcher, Blog Talk Radio. You can't turn a corner without running into one of us, and you'd rather run into me than you would Laura.
Ain't that the truth?
Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time, live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of independent wrestling. You better listen.
Whoop.
Everybody, Bunkhouse Bob and Lovely Lori here. Folks, does the man make the title, or does the title make the man? Age-old question with a simple answer. That is, if you're wearing a title made by Top Rope Belts.
Established in 2006, and with a satisfied client list, including Lucha Underground, the LA Dodgers, New Japan Pro Wrestling, Ohio Valley Wrestling, the National Wrestling Alliance, and many, many more. Top Rope Belts uses 100% custom drawing and does all of their own etching. That means quality from start to finish, folks.
Folks, whether you're a private collector, a wrestling promotion, or a business who wants a quality championship title belt, look no further than Top Rope Belts. Check them out on Facebook or visit them at www.topropebelts.com.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
We are the yin and the yang, the peanut butter and the jelly, the lettuce and the tomato of wrestling podcasts. Well, yeah, sure. I know that you're kidding, and please don't call me Shirley.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
In the wrestling world, there is 6 degrees of separation between myself and professional wrestling. I'm like the Kevin Bacon of professional wrestling.
And the lovely Laura.
Diarrhea is one of those words that just sounds wonderful when you say it. Diarrhea, but not so wonderful in, you know, definition.
Hey, everybody. Thank you for listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is The Bunkhouse Bob, and I am the greatest wrestling mind of the 21st century, and this is episode 236, Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. Folks, we've got a phenomenal guest, a great guest coming up for you in about 30 minutes. She is the current reigning, defending, and undisputed NWA Women's Champion. Jazz will be joining us coming up here in about 30 minutes. Looking forward to having the opportunity to speak with her. Again, folks, we thank you for tuning in. However you listen to the show, if you listen as we do it live, we're on a ton of other places that we're at. Some places I didn't even know that we were at. But if you Google Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, you can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, FNX Network, YouTube, and a bunch of other platforms. So however you listen to it, we greatly appreciate it. We would also appreciate it if you went over to ProWrestlingTees.com and typed in FNX Network up in the search bar. There are two Live from the Armory Wrestling Show shirts for you to choose from. We would ask that you would purchase a shirt and help support this show. While you're supporting things, go over to Twitter and give a follow to @indie_customs. We would appreciate that. And again, please check out all of the great content that is available on the network, not the E-Network, but www.fnx.network. We would appreciate that. If you have a question for myself or Laura or George, a critique or criticism about a guest or an opinion, you can always hit us up at asktheArmory@gmail.com. And probably the best thing we could do right now, and well, no, not the best thing, because she was feeling a little under the weather today. I thought we could do like a dance break segment, but I don't think that Laura feels like dancing tonight. Do you, Laura? You want to do a dance break?
I do not, Bob, no.
What? You don't want to do a techno pop dance break?
I'd love to see you do one.
Well, I'm doing it right now. That's the great thing about doing podcasting or internet radio. I'm dancing
video
right now.
Video or it didn't happen.
Well, we're not live streaming anything, so no. I mean, you just
doesn't
have
matter.
To take
you
my
put that
word
on Twitter.
I could.
Well, I mean,
could.
You photographed yourself, you know, after you, you know, did a thumb, shit. Well, if you did an elbow drop on a bunch of thumbtacks. So you
I did do that.
Do that.
But I won't do a dance break. Well, you know, it's just that I did that for ratings, and it didn't get me anywhere except a bunch of thumbtacks in my arm. So, you know, so much for glorified stunt work. That, you know,
them's the breaks.
Them's the breaks. Them's the tax. How are you tonight?
I'm all right.
You're all right. Hip bone a little sore.
Hip bone.
Yeah, and then where they give you the flu shot?
No, they give you the flu shot in your hip?
Well, I don't know. Ooh.
What do you mean you don't know? Have you not gotten the flu shot lately?
No, I haven't. I don't trust them. People get sick from the flu shot. Inside joke, folks. Inside joke. No, I haven't had the flu shot. You know, it's funny as you mentioned it, and we were talking about this. Knock on wood, I have not been sick all year. I've not had a cold. I mean, I had allergies in the spring, but I've not been sick all year. So,
well, you better
watch. I'll come down with the bubonic plague next week.
Well, you better, you know, say your prayers and eat your vitamins come WrestleCade,
yeah.
Because we always end up getting. End up getting some kind of funk, some kind
I'm
of crud.
I know exactly what that's from, and I've learned my lesson. I'm fist bumping this year. I'm not shaking hands. I'm not doing it.
That's a good
what
idea.
It's from. Either that or carrying around a bottle of hand sanitizer, because that's exactly what it's from. Shaking all those hands. I can tell you, how many people's hands do you think you shook that weekend?
I don't know, 500.
I mean, it's law of averages, folks. Law of averages. So, yeah, I'm going to do the fist bump thing. Pretty sure. Well, you, won't you fist bump us right into social media?
Well, George Fist Bump Coles is on the Twitter machine. At From the Armory. You can tweet along live with him today, tonight. Whatever this is. You can also follow along in the lives of myself, Bob, George, and our good friend Dr. Goose at Circle Sky, at Bob_Delph, at Heel Heat, at The Gray Lobster, all respectively on Twitter, and see what, you know, we all get into on a daily basis. Also, you can find us on Facebook. You can join the official Live from the Armory page, and you can also join our fan page. We have a YouTube channel. Is it a channel or that's what you call it, right? YouTube channel?
Yeah.
And you can just search for Live from the Armory there in YouTube, and you can find every show that we've done for the past 2 years up on YouTube. So if you're out making your town, you can listen to, you know, Dr. D, which John bought me the book. He just gave it to me Sunday. I haven't had a chance to read that yet, but I'm looking forward to getting that read. I got to post a picture of it on Dr. D's fan Facebook page so he won't know, so that he will know that I won't fib any. So,
right.
But that's where we are on the social media shtick.
How was your week?
Pretty eventful. John and I ended up going to RWA on Sunday.
Yeah, I saw a ton of, I don't know, at least three or four times a day, I would see posts about that show.
Well, it was a great thing to see Joe Black wrestle again. I've not seen him in a very long time.
Yeah.
And if it is at all possible, the man's gotten better.
Really?
So okay. He wrestled Jacob Ryan for the cruiserweight. And that was probably match of the night easily. The Gymnasty Boys wrestled. It was good to see White Mike and Timmy Lou. Hadn't seen them in a long time. I got to see our friend James Ryan, who is entertaining, you know, more than anything in this world. He is so entertaining.
Right.
Works the crowd well, works his opponent really good. I'm just going to hit the highlights, and I'm just comment on one match that was not so high. Got to meet our good friend, Brian Pillman Jr.
Okay.
Who took a tumble.
Yes.
I've seen John Skyler do that move I don't know how many times. I think maybe it was just, you know, being off balance. They're both sweating. I don't know. But Mr. Pillman Jr. fell on the floor and hit with a thud. There was a big bump on his shoulder because his shoulder was out of place. But the man got back in the match, and he finished.
Yes.
And not only did he do that, he came back out and talked to people afterwards.
Yeah, I read the follow-up report on that. He had suffered a dislocated shoulder, but not to minimize it, but seems to be none the worse for wear. Expected to make a full recovery for anybody that was wondering.
So our good friend Uncle Bob Evans. He said that he stopped doing podcasts because people were asking the same old questions. And he liked the fact that you and I came up with some original questions.
Okay.
So, and the dude that's with him, Tim Hughes, I was standing up cheering for them when they came out. And he started flipping me with his towel. He scared me to death.
That's cool.
But it was a good show. I was entertained. It was in High Point and Market Week, which if you guys don't know what that means, High Point, North Carolina is the furniture capital of the world. Most of your American-made furniture is made in High Point. And a lot of foreign buyers come to High Point. And the first time I ever came through there was for wrestling, too. Me and my good friend Suzanne, driving through downtown High Point, and I see all these people of Asian descent everywhere. And I'm like, what the hell? Where did all these people come from? And then it was like, you know, welcome to High Point. Welcome to the Market Week. And I'm like, oh, well, that makes sense. The match that really went on longer than it should have was Jillian Strauss versus Rob the Boogie Woogie Man McBride with Jimmy the Boogie Woogie Man Valiant as the referee.
Lots of boogie woogie in there.
It was, Bob, and I knew that this was going to go in the shitter when Jillian Strauss gets a cane out from under the ring. And hits it up against the cage, and it breaks.
Oh, boy.
Everybody behind me, there were people that were working the show. You couldn't help. You just couldn't help but laugh. But basically, it was something that probably shouldn't have happened. And I'm sure that Julian will tell you that, too. But the coup de grace was this guy comes down to the ring in a Shark Boy mask. And we're all like, who the hell is this? And I'm listening as he's talking, trying to figure out who he is. He's got a taser in his hand. He tases old Rob McBride. So and then he takes his mask off and he, Johnny Fairplay.
Old Johnny Fairplay.
Yeah. So he's going to be back in RWA.
Okay.
All
right. That's good to know.
Yeah.
I'm still stuck on the Kane thing, but okay.
And he had a crowbar that was rubber.
If you're going to use props and wrestling, folks, you want to make sure that you at least have legitimate props or the fans are backed up far enough away that, you know, they can't tell that they're rubber crowbars and cut canes. One of the two. Brother. What else happened to you this week? Other than
what?
Broken canes and rubber
irons. As far as wrestling went, you know, I don't want to put RWA down because the show was a good show. It was well attended.
Yeah.
I got to meet JJ from Good Times.
Yeah. And we've all been there. I'm not trying to make light of anything. We've all been there, folks. There have been to several shows, and there's always that one faux pas or that one match. It just, you know. It happens. It's pro wrestling. It's, you know, it's entertainment.
Well,
it is what it is.
Julian, I said it's indie wrestling, you know, because he messaged me and thanked me for coming, which always means a lot when promoters message you and thank you for coming.
Right.
He said, you know, some things worked out, some things didn't, but I appreciate you coming. And I said, well, you know, John and I had a really good time. We saw a lot of people that we did not see, hadn't seen in a long time. And one of the reasons I went was to see Tommy Thomas, and he didn't show up.
Well, of course not. Yeah, we don't want to. I don't want to minimize anybody's efforts or anybody's work or the, you know.
No, not at all.
It happened. Certainly.
And you know, it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun. And like I said, you know, Joe Black. Why in this world this man is not on a national stage at some company is beyond me.
I'm glad to see that he's healthy and back in the ring, because the last thing that we heard from Joe Black, last thing I heard anyway, was he had to go have some medical tests done because he was having issues with seizures and so on and so forth.
That's
but it wasn't concussion related. It wasn't concussion symptoms. It was just a natural event, medical event that he was actually going through. And, I'm glad to see that he's back in the ring, medically cleared to compete, because Joe Black's a hell of an athlete, and I agree with
you.
I don't understand why he's not booked more prominently on more cards, because the guy can go. I mean, there's no denying that.
Beat some really prominent people. He's beat Cedric Alexander. I saw him beat Cedric at Firestar. Elijah Evans. How could I have forgotten that? Made an appearance at RWA wearing the PWX title.
A little interpromotional exchange.
Right. And they've done that before. And it was just, they allowed me to stand inside while I was waiting to buy tickets. The other people who had already had tickets had to wait outside, but they allowed me to stand inside. And so I happened to see Elijah in the hallway, and I was just like, I grabbed my, you know, chest a la Fred Sanford and was like, you know. So I didn't say anything to anybody. I kept it quiet because, you know, I don't want to spoil anything. So he came out and issued a challenge to anybody in the RWA locker room. So that'll be interesting to see, you know, who comes
who steps up.
Elijah.
Who steps up. That's cool. I'm a big fan of interpromotional stuff. So
I'm
down with it 100%.
You know, RWA's a little behind. Oh, Shannon Moore won the heavyweight championship from Tim Zabisco.
Really?
So,
okay.
Yeah, that's great.
Shannon's been doing more shows too, so that's
He's
interesting.
He's still in good shape. Let me tell you this. He still is in good shape and still can go. I talked to him very briefly. Had on an NWA shirt, an old NWA shirt with like the National Wrestling Alliance and the blocks and the grapplers,
right.
you know. But yeah, it was a good show. I'm not trying to make light of that fact. It was a good show, that match, and I'm sure anybody else in there would agree was not necessarily the best thing they'd ever seen.
I think that's fair. I think that's fair. I think the good with the bad.
They're going to have another show in January. RWA's a little behind. They got a cruiserweight champion. They got the heavyweight champion, but they do not have tag champions yet. So they're having a tournament right now for their tag team championship, and two of the matches there were for that, you know. It'll be interesting to see how it goes on. And also having a tournament for their ladies championship. So Samantha Starr will go on in January to face our good friend, Miss Savannah Evans, for that championship. So good stuff coming up for RWA in January. And there's lots of good stuff that's coming up in the month of this month still left out. And then, you know, in November, of course, is WrestleCade. And, you know, in December, we all kind of take the month off to recover from said WrestleCade. So.
Okay. You want to go on and hit up the Twitter poll?
Oh, goodness, Bob. I haven't even got Twitter up. Hang on just a second. I've been doing some studying, too. I'm trying to broaden my horizon.
You've been doing some studying, what, on getting a different tablet, or?
You're so not funny.
What? I'm asking questions, that's all.
I'm doing studying for my job. You know,
oh,
Word, Excel, all that good stuff.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay.
Our question is greatly with our guest tonight. What is your level of excitement for the NWA 70th anniversary show? Off the charts, high, somewhat, not at all.
Okay.
Off the charts received 31%.
Okay.
High received 38, somewhat,
okay.
25, not at all, 6%.
Okay.
And I'm thinking that's, you know, I was surprised.
Okay.
But considering who their champion is now, maybe not so much. And there's nostalgia there, too.
Yeah, there is nostalgia there, too. I mean, it is the NWA 70th anniversary show. I think part of it, I know of a few things that have been announced. I mean, obviously, Cody and Nick Aldis, best 2 out of 3 falls match. Our guest tonight, Jazz, will be facing Penelope Ford. I know that there's a tag team match that is scheduled to occur. I just don't know, what's the right word I'm looking for? The level of hype behind of this particular event versus the all-in event. Two different feels, two different vibes, because this is an all-NWA show, presumably, versus a mixture of talents from several different promotions and the NWA title being just a portion of that event.
Right.
I don't know. I mean, for me, it's kind of like, you know, when you listen to the 10 Pounds of Gold series and Billy Corgan, you know, during the opening of every video, they play that same audio clip that history is more than a word, you know, and I think that gets lost on a lot of people. You know, we keep talking about, you know, relevance and prevalent and precedent and all that good stuff, all those big words and where the NWA fits into that today. And I think that for me, this feels more like a celebration as it should, more than a hyped up independent show, which was what All In was.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
It does. It certainly does. All In felt like we're putting up a lot of money here, and we're going to get everything we can. Which, of course, that's what you should do. You put a lot of money into a show, you want to get a lot of money back. You know, it's
right.
totally understandable. But yeah, this is and hopefully gets more eyes on the product. You know, so that maybe the NWA can have, you know, I think it's a great idea of Nick Aldis traveling around to the other promotions, But let's get Jazz to do that. Let's have a tag team tournament and get them to do that, you know, or, you know, maybe a national title. Again, can't have the U.S. title because WWE's got that. But, you know, somewhere along those lines, you know, can we not get this thing going? Can we not get up and running and get this thing to be a thing, to be, to actually be a traveling territory in and of yourself?
Yeah. Yeah, I would think that that's fair. I would think that's fair.
Here, real quick, Bob, let me ask you this. Have you seen these things? Because I had seen them, and I didn't know anything about them. I saw where Adam Page was announcing this was his last T-shirt with the Bullet Club. And I saw some people saying that he, you know, was going to be signed with WWE. Have you heard anything about that?
You know, it's funny you should mention that. I've heard conflicting stories. I have heard that Adam Page turned down a WWE contract, and I didn't take a screenshot of it, but it was kind of odd. It wasn't that long after that, one of the Jackson brothers had posted something about, we're a core group of guys that want to change wrestling, but all of our paths are different at some point. And that right there led me to believe that something is afoot. And I just don't know what the afoot is because...
Could be Marty.
You know, several people know that there are, you know, expiring contracts coming up, and most of them are after the first of the year into January of 2019. I don't know. I don't know. I've heard conflicting stories. I've heard yes and no. So try to find out a little more info on that. I know that he is one of the guys, both Adam Page and Davey Boy Smith were both highly, highly touted on commentary during the New Japan Fighting Spirit event that happened, what was it, a week ago, 2 weeks ago, something like that. Both Kevin Kelly and Jim Ross could not get them over enough. And I'll tell you, out of all the guys that were on that show, they were highly impressive from an athletic standpoint. Davey Boy Smith is an absolute monster waiting to break out if he's not already broken out. I mean, beyond hardcore fans into general fans, if people haven't had the opportunity to look at Davey Boy Smith Jr., who's part of the Killer Elite squad with Lance Hoyt, New Japan Pro Wrestling, you need to get a look at this guy because he is something else. I mean, just something else. But I'm gonna take a break real quick, Laura, and I'll be right back.
Oh, well, hot dog. I'm glad that he decided he was going to do that and, you know, let me know. Thanks a lot, Bob. Bob also had on his thing that he had seen, and his week, one thing, I'll let him talk about. The one he and I both had kind of talked about on Twitter was Austin Aries after the Bound for Glory match, which unfortunately I didn't get to see all of Bound for Glory because I was coming back home from wrestling. But from what I heard, it was a good pay-per-view. My aunt really enjoyed it. I heard the Tessa and Taya Valkyrie match was off the charts. I happen to love the Ally and Sue Young bit. I know a lot of people don't like that stuff, but I loved it, loved it, loved it. The street fight, I don't understand why they couldn't have just filmed some stuff out in the street of New York, because they were. But the taking up the canvas and showing the boards, and the boards were not exactly fitting together, that was kind of a mm-hmm. But... anyway,
you're talking about that concrete jungle match from Impact this past week?
Yeah, that just didn't. But why couldn't they film some stuff? You know what I'm saying? They were in New York. You wanted to have a street fight. Why didn't you just go out in New York City and film some stuff?
Probably because there's enough fighting already. There's enough fighting already in the streets of New York. Why we got to go out and film them fighting in the alleyway?
But it would have made a little more sense. They could have filmed that stuff. They could have went back to the back, shown that footage, then come back fighting. You know what I mean?
They could have.
But we were talking about you and I had you had said something on Twitter, and I'd kind of agreed with you about you know, Austin Aries' behavior after that match.
Yeah, I didn't care for that.
You know, I don't get it. You know, this is you're not some rookie. You're a veteran, and you're going to act that way?
Yeah, kind of mystifying. A lot of people were talking about it, including Petey Williams and Sanjay Dutterson after the event. But we're going to go on and bring a veteran onto the show, somebody that we're very excited to have on this program, because we've been talking a little bit about the NWA's 70th anniversary show coming up this Saturday, October 20th in Nashville, Tennessee. And it is with great honor. What are you doing, eating potato chips? What's that noise?
Well, what are you talking about? I'm just sitting here minding my own business.
Okay. It is with great honor, and we're very, very privileged to have on the show the current reigning, defending, and undisputed NWA Women's Champion. We'd like to welcome to the program Jazz. Jazz, how are you this evening?
I am doing wonderful. How are you?
I am doing just fine on this Wednesday night. And with me, as always, is the other co-host of the program, Laura. Laura, would you like to say hello to Jazz?
Jazz, it is an honor and a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you, Ms. Laura. I love your accent, sweetie.
I'm a little
Southern Belle. Yes, right.
Yeah.
Me too. So we got something in common.
We do. We sure do.
Yes, indeed.
Jazz,
what's going on, guys?
Well, we certainly want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule. I know that you've been doing a ton of media, a ton of press ahead of this event, and we certainly appreciate the time that you've given to us this evening for that. I wanted to go on and address the elephant in the room, Jazz. There have been several posts on social media from wrestlers, some former champions of the NWA brand, that have felt slighted that the only NWA title that it has received any media is the World Heavyweight Championship. Now, NWA's response has been that all parties were informed of the direction of the company after the Billy Corgan buyout. What would your response be to this statement about those maybe feeling slighted? What's your stance, your position with the NWA right now?
Well, understanding the nature of this business, this industry, you know, sometimes you have to just go with the flow. And they told me to chill out. Everything was going to be all good. So that's what I did. They told me to take their word for it. Just be patient. I guarantee you things are going to work out. So I stood still, kept my mouth closed, waited for my time. And now it's my time. It's here. And I'm ready.
Do you feel
you just have to understand what the business is all about, you know?
Right.
And I saw which direction they were going with this, so I knew eventually it had to turn come around towards the women's title. Eventually, you know. So you know, I just set out and waited till it was my time.
And they've done a remarkable job, have they not, with the World Heavyweight Championship? I mean, they have turned that
around
180 degrees, right?
280 degrees, yes. Yes,
right.
They have. Yes, yes. And that's my plan with the women's title.
Yeah, that's your plan?
Did I leave? Hello? You still here?
Yes.
Hello?
No, you caught me off guard. Elaborate for us. What is your plan to move that
because
women's championship?
I'm bringing Jazz to the NWA and what the NWA is all about and what it represents. You know,
right.
Like you said, I've done tons of press this week, and a lot of my stories are basically the same. But my intentions is to – I'm coming in old school style, you know.
Right.
You're not going to see no flips and jumping off ropes from Jazz. You're not going to see that. You're going to see a lot of intensity, a lot of attitude. You know, that's what I'm bringing to the table.
October 21st. Right, and that's kind of what I looked through. I mean, you're currently listed as the NWA's Women's Champion since September 16th of 2016.
Yes.
And I know that it's important for you to carry this both personally and professionally. What kind of pride level? I know I've heard Nick Aldis talk about it. Cody Rhodes has talked about it. For you personally to be the NWA Women's Champion, what does that say to you?
Man, first of all, you know, it's history-making for me alone by being the first African-American woman to ever hold this title. So just to start with that.
Congratulations.
I mean, it's that's legacy right there.
Certainly
you know,
is.
It is. So, and that's why I say this is my legacy, and I'm coming in with the attitude of retaining the title, the NWA, you know, to be in the same category as some of the greatest of all time, you know, your Ric Flairs, your Harley Race, Sting. I mean, you can go, the list can go on and on and on, but to have me to be a part of something this huge and major is just, it's just overwhelming, and it's just, and I thank God for it every day. This is where I'm supposed to be right now. No other place Jazz is supposed to be but where I am right now, sitting as the NWA Women's World Champion.
I want to talk for a moment, Jazz, about some place that you have been in the past, and that's been the WWE. You're a two-time WWE Women's Champion. You're the last to hold the women's title underneath the WWF banner, subsequently then hold it underneath the WWE logo. This term...
Yes, the first to hold the WWE title,
Right. This term of women's wrestling revolution that is making the rounds, and one of your adversaries of the day, Trish Stratus, has made an interesting point in the sense that the work that had been put in by people like yourself and others is being dismissed too quickly, that it all wasn't bra and panties matches. Your thoughts on that time period in women's wrestling, and how hard was it fighting for quality ring time?
It was a little hard, but I mean, the opportunity they gave me, I will forever be thankful for it, you know, because I got to really show the world my craft, the gift that God gave me, you know.
Right.
But we fought tooth and nails to prove to them that we are wrestlers, you know. Sometimes they would say that they had this thing, we were told that the fans don't want y'all wrestling like men, y'all wrestling too much like men. But it's wrestling.
Right.
You know, wrestling fans come to see wrestling, you know. They got titty bars. If they want to go see some girls, you know, with boobs hanging out and the hands, you know, hanging out or no clothes at all,
they can go to the club.
They can pay to go see that. Exactly.
Right.
They have places they can go sit down, you know, and ask, and can in reality touch these girls, you know, to pay to touch them, you know, if they wanted to. But these are wrestling fans. They come to see wrestling. I used a statement the other day, you know, when Ronda Rousey was in the cage, did you want to see Ronda Rousey smash her face, or did you want to see her? Did you want to see her ass hanging out of tights?
Right.
What did the fans pay their ticket? What did they pay their money for the ticket to see?
Right.
Her smash somebody's face.
Exactly.
So therefore, you know, they need to recognize wrestling is wrestling. No matter who's in the ring, it's considered professional wrestling. And women wrestling has evolved so much. When I first started, there was barely women wrestling. Now there's tons of women, and I'm so proud of them all. You know, they're really making, you know, women's wrestling mean something. It's taken over, basically. Women wrestling is really taking over. So
it certainly has.
I'm honored. Yeah, it really is. So I'm just honored to be a part of that.
You know, people keep asking me about
do I feel, should I be in the evolution? I'm creating my evolution October the 21st. That's my evolution.
Ooh.
You know, you mentioned that there are a ton of women now involved in wrestling, and there are numerous all-women's wrestling promotions throughout the United States today. Do you feel the next step at a major promotional level is an all-women's program, or would that defeat the purpose of looking for equality at that level?
There are so many women out here wrestling. You could probably have two or more companies with all women wrestling.
Running full time, yeah.
Yes, running full time. Most definitely at least two to have some competitiveness, you know what I'm saying? So,
right.
Yes, I truly believe that it could happen. If someone's willing to invest, the girl's going to put out the work. That's not the problem. We just need somebody to trust in the product and invest into it. That's all. That's the only thing missing.
Do you feel like taking a call from a listener, Jess?
Yeah, of course. Put them on.
Let's see what we got here. 814, you're on with Live from the Armory Wrestling Show and NWA Women's Champion Jazz.
My question for Jazz is, she ever wrestled Rodney Mack before, and what was the result of those matches? And has she ever done a tag team match?
Have I ever wrestled Rodney Mack? Actually, we had a match one time, but actually we roll around in the ring all the time. Rodney really helps me out a lot with when it comes to my mat work, you know. So, yeah. We wrestle around. And, of course, I always come out as the winner if you want to know, you know, the outcome.
Of
you want to know the outcome, you know.
Because he's a smart man.
That's right. That's all. I'm going to keep his wife happy. He better put me
over. That's right. Happy life, happy wife.
Yeah,
that's
here it comes.
Yes, yes.
Have you ever done a mixed tag team match since this mixed max challenge has been pretty popular on Facebook? And what double team moves do you have if you are a tag team at all?
As far as Rodney and myself, mixed tag, yeah, we've done a few. But you know what? That's what we've been really trying to push it on the indie scene here, trying to, like, do some mixed tags, you know,
yeah,
and not make it so where only women can touch and only men can touch, you know, like, let's go out there and really have a real tag team match. You know, it just so happened to be, you know, a mix, intergender match. That's the only difference.
Right.
So,
right.
Yeah.
Right.
So we're Rodney and Jazz, we're down for that, David. We're waiting. We're waiting
there
for
you
a phone call. We're waiting for that.
Awesome. Awesome. 814, thank you for your call tonight.
Yeah, thanks for taking the call.
Sure.
Yeah.
Your opponent, Jazz, at the upcoming NWA 70th anniversary show is Penelope Ford, and Penelope is no stranger in challenging for the NWA Women's Championship. She's had a past opportunity against then-champion Amber O'Neill. Your thoughts on Penelope Ford, and what do you know about her?
I don't know much about her. Of course, I've you know, been studying her. I've been, you know, watching some matches. But like you said, she's made challenges before, but never against Jazz.
Mm.
That's the big difference right there.
Yes, it is. Huge difference. Huge difference. Okay.
So,
Laura, go ahead. Go ahead, Laura.
I'm sorry my answers may be short. But
I'm just pretty direct.
I understand.
Ain't nothing in the world wrong with being direct and to the point. You know, you talked a little bit about, you know, the women's evolution and, you know, you're starting your own Evolution at the 70th anniversary celebration. And I'm just wondering, you know, with all this talk about the Evolution and the end of the Diva, quote-unquote, era, I feel that there's a narrative missing in there where your story hasn't been told. Do you feel that as well?
I do. I really do. But, you know, there's some political shit going on, excuse my French, and I understand that, and I can't be mad about it. But, again, yes, I should, if it wasn't so political bullcrap behind this, I'm sure I would have probably been involved. But, you know, I can't cry with spilled milk. I got something else to focus on. Like I say, October the 21st, 70th anniversary NWA is my evolution. I'm creating my own. So I can't worry about what they're doing over there. I got to focus on what I'm going to do to Penelope.
And Penelope better be focused too. I think that's wonderful.
But you know what, honestly, I want to give her a hell of a match, and I want her to think the same towards me. You know, I want her to give me
a hell
of a match. You know, I really want to go out there and tear the house down. That's my plan, you know. I want her and I to put on a great match. And like I said, I want the fans and the commentators to put over the fact that we're putting on a hell of a wrestling match. I don't want to hear, oh, that was a cool spot. I don't want to hear that. I want to hear that was a hell of a wrestling match. You women put on a freaking clinic out there. That's what I want to hear.
Well, I have no doubt that's what's going to happen. I have no doubt. I think it's a wonderful attitude to have. It's like, you know, whatever they're doing over there, I can't worry about. I just got control over what I'm doing over here, and I'm going to set the place on fire.
That's it. That's my plan.
October 21st. Y'all better call the fire department, have you some hoses and some buckets.
I just want to let the world know that the baddest bitch is not dead. You know, I took some time off. You know,
right.
I'm not dead.
I took some time off. I'm not dead. You know, don't count me out. I'm still here. And I'm
going
to show the world October the 21st that I am here. I'm back. The bitch is back.
There you go.
I can't wait. I really and truly cannot wait. And talking about the NWA, and we've asked this to people who have been associated with the NWA as of late, and how can the NWA regain its national prominence in this day and age? Are they on the right path with the use of social media, or, you know, are there other avenues that need to be looked at? How can they get back to where they were, say, in the 80s?
Well, I think they're on the right track. You know, if we focus on keeping things old school, a little bit of the new school, because, you know, some of the fans, they like some of the new school style of wrestling, but they're on the right track. And every match is going to bring something different to the table. So that makes the show complete. You know, you're not going to have the same match, you know, back to back. You know, you're not going to see the same thing over and over and over. You know, so I think that's what's going to set the NWA, you know, to where it used to be and where it is, where it's going. You know, I'm sure they're not going to be having 10-minute promos out there and, you know, and 2-minute matches and another 15-minute segment of a promo, you know. So, you know, they're having wrestling matches. So that's what I believe. That's the way they're taking this right now.
Well, I mean, that's what's on the marquee, wrestling. You know,
that's it.
Well, it does my heart and Bob's heart good to hear you talking about. Not that we don't like spots, because we do. We like flippy stuff, but we also absolutely,
and nothing's wrong with that. Nothing's wrong with that. I just say you're not going to see that from jazz.
Right, and we love to see just good wrestling, mat wrestling, some use some psychology, wear your belt to the ring for crying out loud, that kind of old school stuff that we really Bob and I grew up on.
Let a heel be a heel, let your face be a baby face. I'm not going out there as a heel trying to get a baby face pop.
Right.
Mm.
I want to hear the boos.
Right.
I want to hear the boos. See, that's what we need more heels
hear
in
the
this
boo.
Business.
I hate you. You suck.
Right.
Well, mentioned Rodney Mack just a little bit ago, and I'm just curious, what's the hardest thing that you've encountered being a wrestler who is married to a wrestler?
That's a hard question because we're really a team, you know what I mean? Like, throughout the preparation for October the 21st, he's been right here by my side helping me prepare for this mentally and physically, you know what I mean? You know, we go to the ring, we're working on stuff in the ring, he's in the gym, got me pushing weights like crazy in the gym, watching film, we're breaking stuff down, watching film. So, you know, he's my partner in crime. He's right there. I just wish, he could be there on the 21st, but unfortunately he won't be able to make this one. But, I'm going to represent for him and my babies.
That's right. You got twins, right?
I have twins, yes. Yes. And they're starting to like wrestling now, which is kind of scary. It's kind of scary. I was totally against it, but my husband says, then I'm being a hypocrite. How are you going to love something and do it, but you don't want your kids to do it?
Right.
Oh, all right. As long as we're the ones training them, okay.
That's right.
Yes. But I'm definitely excited about October 21st, do the fans know the tickets and all this?
Yep,
have you announced that?
Not yet, but we will just after this last thing.
Okay.
And I'll give you opportunity to fully plug it. Win, lose, or draw. This match has huge implications, not only for you, but for the NWA as well. Mm-hmm. What do you want fans to know walking in as the NWA champion, and what do you want them to walk away with when it's all over with, Jazz?
What I want the fans to walk away with. I want them to walk away with within their mind and heart and where they can feel the passion and the love that I have for this business. Through my match, I want them to be able to feel that. That's what I'm trying to put out there. And I want them, regardless heel or whatever, boo or whatever, but I want them to show me some love when Jim Cornette says, and still, the NWA Women's World Champion, Jazz. You can hate it, you can love it, but those are the words they're going to hear.
That's right.
That's the words that we want to hear for
sure.
And still.
And still.
And still, the NWA Women's Champion, the NWA 70th anniversary.
Logo. And still.
And still. That's a shirt. That is a shirt.
That can mean anything. Still the baddest bitch. Steal this,
steal whatever. That's right. That's right. It goes with a lot of stuff. The NWA 70th anniversary show, Sunday, October the 21st at the Nashville Fairgrounds. If you want to get tickets for it, you can go to globalforcewrestling.com. Tickets are available through there. You can find them at other major ticket outlets. All you got to do is get on that little handheld device that you all carry around and type in NWA 70th Anniversary Show, and it pops right up. Jazz, thank you so much for coming on the show tonight. We had an absolute blast.
Thank you.
It was an honor.
We sure did.
With you
it was
tonight.
An honor.
I want to wish you the best
thank
of luck
you.
This Sunday. Thank you so much.
I'm not really crazy. I just sound like it sometimes. I'm not really cray-cray.
No, we didn't.
It's all good. It's all good.
Hashtag cray-cray. I'm not really crazy, but, yeah.
Jazz, thank
yes,
you again so much.
But I hope you guys are going to be at the show.
Unfortunately,
I am not going
not.
To travel to Nashville.
Yes.
No, but it is available on pay-per-view. It is available
yes.
on the Fight Network.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. Just watch it. Yes.
We'll be there
sure will.
In spirit.
And then we'll do a
visit.
Recap afterwards. Then we can
awesome.
Talk afterwards.
Okay.
We'll do.
Okay, Jazz. Thank
sounds
you so much.
Like a plan. All right. Thank you,
right.
guys. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Have a great night. All right.
All right, baby. Take care.
Bye-bye.
And there goes the NWA Women's Champion, Jazz. And we'll be back after this brief message.
Hey everyone, lovely Laura asking you, when you think of wrestling snacks, what comes to mind? Hot dogs? Popcorn? What about you, Bob?
Oh, some escargot, oysters Rockefeller, maybe a nice quiche.
You look like a quiche.
Seriously, folks. If you're looking for an awesome treat or a wrestling-inspired gift endorsed by both wrestlers and wrestling fans alike, look no further than Turnbuckle Cupcakes.
You can find Brandy and Julianne on their Turnbuckle Cupcakes Facebook page or visit them at www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com.
Oh, boy. Man, there's a lot of stuff there. A lot of stuff there. What'd you think of Jazz?
Oh, loved her. Absolutely loved her. You know, unfortunately, I wasn't watching WWE at the time in which she
yeah.
was wrestling because I was on, you know, wrestling sabbatical. But
yeah.
I absolutely, you know, reading all the stuff I read about her and just, you know, I think her name gets left out a lot when you talk about Trish and Lita. And she was right up there with them. I mean, she was, you know, two-time women's champion. I mean, how can you leave her out?
Yeah, there's a gray area there in that transitional time. You know, and I think, and to me, it's odd that conversation seems to be glossed over in the sense that she was the last person to hold the title under the WWF banner. And as they subsequently transitioned into World Wrestling Entertainment, she was the first to hold it underneath that logo. That's a huge milestone in
yes,
that in that time frame of women's wrestling. And I think she brought up a very valid point in that we've talked a lot about, you know, what women's wrestling was and what it is today. And I think that her analogy is spot on. With this influx of today's athlete, the Ronda Rouseys, the Rhea Ripleys, and the Ruby Riots, and all these extremely, hugely talented ladies that are there, what are we actually paying to see? Are we paying to see wrestling, or are we paying to see girls still in revealing outfits and in corny ass sketches and all that other junk that was so prevalent during the Attitude Era? I think what she said right there pretty much encapsulates what we have talked about the Attitude Era, what it was and what it wasn't, in a nutshell, in a totally different light. You know, you can hear the conversation that's going on backstage with the segment producers of that day. What are the people really paying for? Or that they're paying to see people wrestle, not us wallow around in a jello-filled kiddie pool. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, and, I think that's what they've always paid for. It just depends on who's booking it.
Yeah,
I mean,
well,
wrestling's on the marquee.
Yes, and well, I would agree with that to a certain extent. I think that there were those that were diehard fans that really wanted to see that, but the demographic that they were aiming at the, in the attitude area,
yeah.
let's face
men
it.
Being
I mean,
men,
we had a
yeah.
lot of
yeah.
Yeah, we had men being men. We had a lot of 16-year-old pimple-faced boys, you know, that had posters adorned all over their walls that really weren't concerned about a hammerlock.
Oh, yeah, I totally agree with that. Yeah.
So,
depends on who you're aiming for.
Yeah, who your target audience was. But absolutely phenomenal. And I need to apologize. I at the beginning when I announced her, I had the date wrong. It is Sunday, October 21st, not October the 20th. Sunday, October 21st is the NWA.
Yeah, y'all don't show up the 20th and
yeah, well,
expect
can,
to see some wrestling. And then
well,
you'll get Matt Bob.
Well, you can show up. Just bring a tent. That's all you got to do. Just bring a tent. You'll be okay. You know, a sleeping bag and maybe something to eat. But you'll be all right. Yeah, just really, really excited. And I'm glad that there was clarification on her end. Because I have read, and I know you have too, there have been other people. And we've spoken to them. And some of them have told us, you know, in not so roundabout ways, what the game plan was when Billy Corgan bought the NWA. So now folks know, I mean,
right.
It's out here in the open. The idea was, is that they were going to focus on the World's Heavyweight Championship. And then there's a plan in place to subsequently start working on other aspects of the NWA. But their concentration, and I think all things being equal, it being the oldest professional wrestling championship and probably the most recognizable championship, that's where their focus had to be. Now, I'm not trying to say that the men's title is more prevalent or has stronger weight than what the women's championship does, but that title was recognized first. So I can see the thought process on it. They told her, and you heard it right from Jazz herself, just relax. We've got a plan in place. Trust us. We want you on board with this. We'll let you know what's going on. And here we are, lo and behold. So I would look for more things to start happening, not only with the World's Championship, the Women's Championship, and like what you had said, Laura, hopefully soon with the Tag Team Championship. There's a plan in place.
I hope so. I really do. I would really love to see, you know, them crown a tag team and then have, you know, this tag team to go around to other promotions and defend the title.
Right. Right. No, I agree with you. I agree with you. I wanted to jump backwards if we could, and again, want to thank Jazz for coming on the show tonight, and really appreciate her time.
Yeah, she was great.
It's always great. Always great to have people on.
Well, you know, Chris Riddle was very jealous that we were having her on.
Yeah.
He told me that Saturday. He was like, "I'm very jealous of you and Bob having Jazz on." And I'm like, "Well, you know, I mean, it's what we do."
That's what happens, Riddle, when you got stroke. That's what happens. Wanted to go over a couple of things. I wanted to touch on what you were talking about before I had to jump off air and make a phone call. The Bound for Glory match, Austin Aries, the John Morrison thing, and, you know, I watched the whole pay-per-view itself. What was great was that, you know, Impact will put up 3 and 4 minute video clips of different
right.
things. And I did see some of the clips from a majority of the matches. The Tessa Blanchard, Taya Valkyrie match looked to be an absolute barn burner, but the Austin Aries, John Morrison match, they did show the end match in it, the last 4 minutes of the match in its entirety. You know, Morrison goes up and hits what the Moonlight Drive, I think is his finisher, is called. Rolls
or the
over.
Starship Pain. Yeah.
Yeah. Starship Pain, my fault. Pins him 1, 2, 3. He rolls over. Then Austin rolls over, pops up, climbs the turnbuckle, mm-hmm. flips the crowd off, climbs through the rope, starts walking the apron. You can see Morrison sit up and is mouthing the words. Obviously, you can't hear the audio because the music's playing. But you can see him obviously mouthing the words, "What the fuck?" And Morrison, Aries walks the apron, gets onto the ramp, shines everybody the bird, does it a couple more times, walks on off. Review goes out. You know, a lot of people felt like it was some type of a work, that Aries would be at, you know, they're currently taping in New York for the next round of shows. Austin Aries is officially no longer with Impact Wrestling. That match was his last scheduled appearance for Impact. Read a follow-up interview with Petey Williams, who is not only a wrestler for Impact Wrestling, but he's also a segment producer backstage. He was asked about it. The only thing that Williams would say is it is what it is. Austin Aries is no longer under contract with Impact Wrestling. He's fulfilled his dates. And that's that. So what does that do? Number one, it makes Austin Aries look unprofessional as hell. Whatever beef that you had with, you know, Impact, maybe them not wanting to extend your contract, or you not getting together with terms, it makes you look unprofessional, number one. And number two, it makes the work that you just did in the ring, not only your work, but John Morrison's work, like a sham. It makes it look irrelevant. It makes it look terrible. And I feel bad for John Morrison, who seemingly is a consummate professional. I'm sure that he doesn't agree with every finish or every booking, you don't see him no-selling a move, rolling out of the ring, flipping the crowd off, and walking up the ramp and getting his bag and leaving.
My question is, who does he think he is?
That's what
I want to know.
Well, this is touted as their biggest show of the year. You know, they had the Abyss induction into the Impact Hall of Fame, gave a very moving speech. I got to see all of the speech in its entirety. Very, very well-spoken individual. Thanked a lot of people. You know, just a nice guy that got to do his thing.
Yeah.
You know, you had great matches, a great card. The Impact ship is turned around, you know, going full sail ahead. And then you got to, unbeknownst to everybody else, because you don't know what he's going to do, then you've got this bullshit at the end of this, of your biggest pay-per-view in front of a hot crowd. And that's how you have to go off the air, with one person's selfish actions. And that's all it was. It was selfishness. I don't get it.
Again, who does he think he is? How many other places does he, unless he doesn't want to wrestle anymore, how many other places do you think he's got to go? Do you think Ring of Honor wants him after doing that shit?
I mean, he's worked for Ring of Honor in the past. I don't know what his relationship with Ring of Honor is. It's obvious what his relationship is with, I don't think that he's going anywhere near the WWE. And if I am in management at Ring of Honor, New Japan, WWE, and I see this, and I'm like, in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, well, what if something happens and this guy doesn't want to do what's best for business? Is he going to do that on our pay-per-view?
Right.
Is he going to do that at, you know, Glory by Honor? Or is he going to do that at, you know, at the Tokyo Dome? You know, what will set him off that he will do this and embarrass us as a company? Because not only did he embarrass himself, he embarrassed Impact Wrestling by doing that.
Yeah. And there might be a lot of people watching that pay-per-view who'd never watched Impact pay-per-view because John Morrison's on Survivor.
Right. Or they had given up on Impact and they're just now getting back on board with it.
Right. And then that bullshit happens. It's like, someone needs to, you know, answer who does he think he is? Because that's what it is to me. It's a overinflated self-importance issue. Because obviously that's what it was with WWE.
There's no denying that the guy has in-ring ability. there's no denying that the guy is quick-witted on the microphone. There's no denying that we just talked about this last week, that he was using social media to garner more interest in this,
right.
You know, this, that, and the other. You know, I don't understand the level of selfishness that's involved with this. I can't comprehend that, why you would want to do that to, you know, a guy that you're putting trust in the ring, you know, to the people in the back that, you know, that have worked with you, that, you know, they put the damn heavyweight championship on you, is how much faith they had in your ability.
They did it twice.
And this is how you repaid them. This is how you thank them. So, I don't know. I lost a lot of respect, at least on the, you know, on the professional side of Austin Aries from that little move. Some people think it's cool. I think it's a bunch of bullshit.
I don't know how in the world you could think that was cool.
You've got a certain group that thinks that, you know, you're getting something over on the man. He didn't get anything over on the man. The only thing that he got was not getting an invitation back. Right. You're not going to get an invite back. If I'm sitting there and I'm in upper level, I'm Sanjay Dutterson and I'm Petey Williams and I'm Ed Nordum, and I'm sitting there thinking, you know, we were going to offer this guy another contract, you know, 6 months down the road, you know, let him go do what he wanted to do. I'd be damned if I'd be bringing him back.
Yeah, I wouldn't offer him, you know, to take the tickets. I wouldn't even let him do that. I mean, this is just monumentally stupid. If you were angry, you know, do that shit in the back.
Right. So on that, on the scope of professionalism, we have, you know, Austin Aries on one side. And then on the other side, we've got a guy like John Saxon, who's been a guest on this show.
Yeah, I saw that. I'm very sorry to hear that he's retiring.
John Saxon announced his retirement from professional wrestling. For folks that weren't familiar or aren't familiar with John Saxon's work, his body of work stretches 20-plus years in the professional wrestling industry. He's worked for numerous promotions, was on TCW Wrestling out of Arkansas, which is still in syndication overseas. An absolute ring general. Had worked with the NWA through some of the NWA's lowest points. Just an all-around phenomenal stand-up guy, and the true consummate professional in every sense of the word. And certainly want to wish John Saxon nothing but the absolute best in his retirement from active competition. John is one of those guys that just is an encyclopedia of professional wrestling, knowing what works and what doesn't and why it didn't work and when to holler and when to be silent and what look to give and all of that other stuff rolled up into one. And in my opinion, one of the last pure wrestlers that I think that I've gotten to see in my lifetime. I mean, just an absolute pure professional wrestler. So wanted to give a huge shout out to him. The other thing I wanted to talk about, and I know that you weren't feeling well yesterday during SmackDown, but I know that it's been on Raw. And I know that fans have picked up on this because it's been on social media this week, strangely absent over the course of the last week, especially during Raw and SmackDown. You know, the WWE is still talking about their crown jewel event. The funny thing
is, they're not saying where it's going to be.
The funny thing is that they're not mentioning emanating from Saudi Arabia or having all the particular information about it. So major media outlets such as Sports Illustrated and ESPN are questioning WWE's Saudi Arabia commitment to the crown jewel event after the murder torture and murder of Washington Post journalists. And a lot of fans are asking the same thing. What does WWE really going to benefit out of this if they go on and go forward with the show, other than the obvious millions that they've already been promised by the Saudi government? I'd love to hear your thought. I know you've had issues with them being there from just the social standpoint, the human aspect of it, the women's side of it.
Human rights stuff.
And now we've got this murder that's been thrown into the mix. But the thing is it even too late for the WWE to pull out now from a production standpoint? I mean, this show is what, November the 2nd? I'm sure that there would already be things in place. Not that there's people over there, erecting the stage and the set and all that, but I mean, the WWE is a company, a corporation. It's a small army of people that takes mm-hmm. to put on an event this size. Are the wheels that are set in motion, is it too late to stop that?
Well, that's a great question. But the thing of it that you really have to weigh, and I think maybe Vince is waiting to see, because, Vince's wife is in the cabinet. I saw in the news today that Trump is like, we want to get to the bottom of this, but, Saudi Arabia has a deal with us for billions of dollars of weaponry for arms.
Yeah,
so
that's true.
I feel as though that's going to be the key, is to how Trump responds to this. Because the Saudis have already said, if we sanction them over anything, they're going to cut oil production.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the world's oil comes from Saudi Arabia. So, with that being said, I really think playing a waiting game to see what the administration's going to do. If the administration does nothing, I feel that he'll go on with it.
I think you're absolutely right. I think this has deeper political ties for several reasons, some of them that you mentioned. And I think one of them, and obviously this isn't a political podcast, but I think one of them is whether or not, what's the right word that I'm looking for, the right term, if the Saudi prince is going to be implicated in this, or if he
right.
if this happened unbeknownst to him by, inner workings of the Saudi government for whatever reason, who had knowledge and who didn't,
who has plausible deniability. Who knew what when?
Exactly. I think that if that focus is shifted away, that the major players within the Saudi government can be dismissed as not knowing anything about what transpired, that this in fact happened underneath someone else's own hand, then I think everything will move forward. If there is some type of implication behind the crown prince of Saudi Arabia, or however this works, I'm not well versed enough with the Saudi government to say, but if there's direct implications involved and things politically become messy and there's collateral damage involved, then I think that you'll probably see them beg off and the event be held in a different area. How they're going to do it, I don't know. But again, the WWE is a small army. And when you get that phone ringing and on the other end is, officials saying, look, we're going to make this happen, and in turn, this is what's going to happen economically in your area, especially on an overseas show, things can happen relatively quickly. So it is just a waiting game, but the window of waiting is narrowly closing. I mean, we already have things in place, wheels in motion. So I know that, JBL had said on a political news show that he felt that that the event should go on as planned, that, you know, the WWE cannot respond to real world political issues, that, you know, they're an entertainment company, which Vince McMahon reiterated it about five times last night, World Wrestling Entertainment. You know, we're here to entertain people.
Well,
that's what
that.
We do. We entertain people. He just kept
but
driving
what
it home.
What about the wrestlers?
Well, and you know, there was a report that came out that, you know, some of the wrestlers felt uncomfortable. Listen, I am sure that, you know, that people feel uncomfortable, you know, traveling to foreign countries all the time. And I am sure that the WWE could hire enough private security to walk people all around wherever they wanted to go without them getting a scratch on them if they wanted to. You don't think that security isn't tight at any event? I mean, I know that when we went to WrestleMania, we had to go through two sets of scanners. We went through one that you walked through, and then they wanded you down before you even got in the door. So, you know, it's one of those things.
But
that,
you know what? The thing of it is when you got security like that, that's all fine and good when you're on, but you're not in your own country. That's what would, you know, really, those are the reservations I would have about it. All this is going on, and I'm not in America. I'm over here right where it's, you know, of course, this happened in Turkey, but, you know, I just think that from a humanitarian point of view, and this is just my own opinion, I think they ought to pull out. And maybe, you know, if they want to go back after all the dust settles or whatever, fine. But I just don't think that it makes the WWE look good as a company by doing this now.
Yeah, on the heels of that event, it sometimes, you know, like I had said, discretion is the better part of valor. And a lot of times, if you give enough time to something, you know, time has a way of easing people's memories and easing even more their conscience during different events. And I'm kind of in agreement with you. I'm thinking at this point, just because it's such a hot button topic, you know, but again, it's, you know, it's World Wrestling Entertainment. You know, and I just keep going back to that. I just found it so odd that when Vince McMahon came out, that he just kept hammering that home, and nothing happens in professional wrestling without a reason. And, you know, kept telling everybody, we're here to entertain, we're here to entertain. And that just, it felt like a deflection to me. You know what
of
I mean? Win, lose,
yeah,
or draw.
Yeah, we're the little entertainers over here. We make you laugh, and you know, we don't have anything to do with.
Yeah, exactly. We're not part of that. Exactly, we're not part of that. We're like a traveling movie company coming to your town to film a show. Entertainment. Well, you want to go on and pop off a couple of events that we've got listed, and we'll put this one in the can.
Sure. We got PWX Presents Monsters Among Us, Sunday, October 21st, at the Cabarrus Arena in Concord, North Carolina. You can find out more information by visiting www.pwxpro.com. Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment presents Live and Let Die, Sunday, October 21st, at the Furnace 41 Club in Jonesboro, Georgia. You can find out more information at www.AtlantaWrestlingEntertainment.com.
Awesome. Go on and announce next week's guest. Next week on this show, we'll have on a couple of people from the great state of Texas will be joining us. The Outlaw Randy Wayne and his manager Miranda Gordy will be joining us. That name sound familiar to you at all, Laura?
Gordy. Yeah, it does, Bob.
Yeah. maybe our listeners will do a little research before they maybe. Listen to this episode. The Outlaw Randy Wayne and Miranda Gordy will be talking to us next week. Don't forget, folks, we're just a couple of short weeks away from being on the road to WrestleCade. Make sure you go to www.wrestlecade.com for all of your tickets, information, all that great stuff that comes along with WrestleCade. We are not that far off. I think there is, I don't know, what is there? Let's see, what's today? We're almost a month away, 4 weeks away.
Almost. This is October 17th.
Yeah. Yeah, you're getting very close. So make sure you go to www.wrestlecade.com, get your tickets. You want to make sure you do that. Do you have anything else you want to add before we call tonight?
I would. I'd just like to thank everybody for tuning in and supporting the show. And, you know, go to prowrestlingtees.com and buy a T-shirt. You know, come on. You know you want to. And if you're interested in the little T-shirt that we put out of Bob and I looking like Funko Pops, let us know. We're still trying to get that together, maybe do a small limited run. We just appreciate everybody for being fans and thinking that Bob and I, you know, are entertaining and put on a decent wrestling podcast. So thanks, everybody.
Yep. I want to mention, too, if you're on Twitter, make sure you go over to the Wrestle Hub, and you can find them at the Wrestle Hub. We've been nominated in several categories for this particular podcast. Check that out. Make sure that you vote at From the Armory on the Wrestle Hub Podcast Awards. Want to collect something? I think we get something. I don't know what it is, but you know, piece of paper, small trophy, plaque. Something, I don't know.
Gift card
to, yeah, wherever. Gift card to McDonald's. Folks, we thank you very much for listening to this episode of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. Whether you listened live on Blog Talk Radio, on iTunes, Stitcher, FNX.network, YouTube, all that great stuff. We'll be back here next Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern, live without a net. And remember, there's never a bad seat here at the Armory. Thanks for listening. Enjoy your week.
You have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network. And we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
Officer, I'd like to file a report. I witnessed a robbery.
A robbery?
Yes, at Sonic. I saw a man steal a quarter-pound double cheeseburger and tots for only $2.99. He was about 6'1", brown hair, blue shirt, big smile.
Wait, so he did actually pay just $2.99? I better check this out. Boys, I'm going on lunch.
It's a steal, all right. The Car Hop Classic, a quarter-pound double cheeseburger or Slinger Plus Tots for only $2.99. This is how you Sonic.
Text not included. See menu for details for a limited time. Only participating Sonic drive-ins.
911.
Officer, I'd like to file a report. I witnessed a robbery.
A robbery?
Yes, at Sonic. I saw a man steal a quarter-pound double cheeseburger and tots for only $2.99. He was about 6'1", brown hair, blue shirt, big smile.
Wait, so he did actually pay just $2.99? I better check this out.
Boys, I'm going on lunch.
It's a steal, all right. The Car Hop Classic, a quarter-pound double cheeseburger or Slinger Plus Tots for only $2.99. This is how you Sonic.
Text not included. See menu for details for a limited time. Only participating Sonic drive-ins.